Ramesh to Arif, can you tell us a little bit about Janagraha and its significant achievements to date?
Janagraha is a non-profit that's based in Bangalore, and we work on improving quality of life in our cities and towns. We define quality of life as having two components. One is the quality of infrastructure and services, the roads, the water, the traffic, the garbage, the pollution, things like that. And the second aspect of quality of life that we feel is important is the quality of citizenship, because ultimately in a democracy we need to improve not just the way we see the tangible parts of the city, but also how much of an ownership we take over our cities. So for Janagraha, both these are important aspects of quality of life in our cities and towns. And what we do is to look to improve both of them. And to do that, we work with both government and with citizens. So both supply side reforms as well as demand side participation. Over the last 10 years, we've had many areas where we've had challenges and failures, but we've had some share of successes. One example of the success with the government is the Jawaharlal Nehru National Urban Renewal Mission, which was launched in 2004. We played a very significant role in launching that mission and in designing that mission. Two of the reforms in that mission were drafted by Janagraha, the Community Participation Law and the Public Disclosure Law. Similarly, on the demand side, on engaging citizens, we have several campaigns where we've looked to bring citizens on board. One example is we partnered with Tata Tea to get youths to register to vote in the 2009 elections through a campaign called Jagore, where over 6 lakh youth across 23 cities registered. And on the basis of that, we now have an MOU with the Election Commission of India. So those are examples of the kind of things that we do.
Can you tell us a little bit about the I Paid a Bribe campaign?
So I Paid a Bribe is an example of a campaign that's focused on citizens. And our approach was, clearly corruption is an issue that is at the heart of many challenges that India faces. But what we said was, rather than moralize about corruption, let's acknowledge that corruption is a part of our day-to-day life. The second aspect is that we didn't care as much about what you could call wholesale corruption, the 2G scam or the Commonwealth Games. But we said, let's focus on retail corruption, the corruption that you and I face in our day-to-day lives, getting a driver's license, registering a piece of land, getting a birth certificate for our children and so on. And we said, that's the kind of corruption that erodes at the public consciousness. You know, so let's address that first. And over time, let the wholesale corruption or let other people address that. So the approach we've taken is to crowdsource information on corruption. So the ipaidabribe.com site is basically saying, you know, I paid a bribe. I was caught going fast in a road and I paid a bribe to avoid paying a taxi and a traffic penalty. I paid a bribe to get my land, etc., etc. And the logic behind that was to say, if we could collect all this information, then we could use that data to then get business process changes inside government. Because when you go to government and tell them, hey, you need to change your RTO system, very often they say, why do you suggest we need to change it, or what do we need to change? So with the I Paid a Bribe initiative, what we now have is Jan Mahiti reports that we are creating for key urban services, where we know that there are evidences of corruption. Today it's become the largest crowdsourced source of corruption across the world. There are 14 countries that are now looking to do sites of I Paid a Bribe. But most importantly and satisfyingly for us, the government of Karnataka has said that 3 services are now going to be changed because of the data that we've shared. One is on RTI, one is on RTO, which is driver's licenses. The other is on stamps and registration, which is land registration. And the third one is on birth and death certificates.
We understand that Janagraha did a ward infrastructure index. We would like to know a little bit about its impact and can it be brought to a city like Mumbai?
Again, at the heart of what we are trying to do, when we say we want citizens to get engaged and we want government to get accountable, is to say, how do we get data that is useful to people? And let's bring this data as close to people as possible. So the unit for us that's really important is the ward, the electoral ward of a city corporation. So a city like Bangalore has 198 wards. Each ward has a corporator. And so we said, let's make that corporator accountable. And how do you do that? If you could measure the quality of life. And we had 6 different categories like water supply, mobility, solid waste, pollution, crime, and so on. Then we could actually say this is, you know, irrevocably the quality of life. You score it on an index of 1 to 10. And then you can say that, you know, this ward has got a score of 7, which is one of the highest wards. And here are the wards which are at 2 or 3, which are the lowest wards. So it suddenly gives the power of information in the hands of people to then hold their elected representatives accountable and also to then make decisions. Maybe in some wards you need to improve access to transport. In another ward you need to improve the quality of the water supply. Those choices need to be made based on data. So it was not an opinion survey, and that was important. It was actual data. So just to give an example, on the water supply, there are two ways that you can do this. One is to just take the service provider, let's say the water and sewerage board, and ask them what is the amount of water you give in a city like Bangalore. And the way they would calculate that is they would just say, so many MLD I'm supplying to the city divided by the population, so this is 120 liters per capita per day. And what we said was that's not good enough, because those numbers can be very different depending on whether you're in a good part of the city or in a slum area of the city. So what we did was we went to randomly selected households in each ward, worked with a Pune-based engineering firm, designed a little unit which we could then plug into the water supply of the of that particular home, and that would then record both the number of hours of supply as well as the pressure of the supply. And at the end you could take that unit and plug it into your computer and you could collect the data. And so this is in some sense irrefutable, because the water supply board can't say, well, we don't accept that data, it's an opinion of a public. It's actual data on water pressure and water supply. And then we would also take a sample which we could then measure the quality on. So this is the kind of thing that we did. We did something like 190,000 data points across these various indicators across 198 wards to ensure that what we got was statistically significant, irrefutable data. And then we scored all the wards on a score of scale of 1 to 10 and published this. As to your second question, can it come to a city like Bombay? Absolutely, but it takes an enormous amount of effort. We are a Bangalore-based firm, so ultimately all these things happen through partnerships.
What is your personal recommendation to increase transparency and accountability in our governance system and leadership?
I think that we should go beyond what the words, because I don't think if you go to a politician or you go to a bureaucrat or you go to any citizens and you say you want transparency, accountability, nobody says no. So I think we need to go to the next level and say, okay, what does that really mean? So to us, for example, we've asked for a public disclosure law. And what we're saying is, why should it be, and Mumbai is the heart of India's commercial business, all the companies, your Reliance or Bombay Dyeing or TCS and all these companies produce quarterly statements, and these statements give you information about the performance of these institutions with standardized information. Why is it that we can't get that kind of quarterly statement from the Bharat Mumbai Municipal Corporation? Why can't we know what were the total receipts for the last 3 months? How much were the expenditures? How did you spend this money? How do you measure whether you are doing well or not? For example, if you look at a private sector company, you know that profitability is a metric. If it's an industry, let's say like software, you know that the bench strength is a metric. You can compare TCS with Infosys, with Wipro. What are the metrics by which we measure Mumbai versus Chennai, Bangalore versus Delhi? There are no metrics. So what we need in order to bring these words like transparency and accountability alive for people is to have three aspects to information. The first is that the information must be timely. It must be to do with something today. It can't be about 1998 because nobody cares. The second is that the information must be standardized. There must be a standard look and feel so that I can use that information and do something with it. And the third of it is that it must be predictable. That means quarter ends on September 30th. I expect the information to come from Reliance on October 10th. From Bharat Mumbai Municipal Corporation, it should come on October 20th, nothing wrong with it. But if you have these three characteristics, which is predictability, standardization and timeliness, you can unleash the power of information in the hands of stakeholders, citizens, elected representatives, managers and so on. So that's one example of making transparency and accountability come alive. There's a whole range of other things, but I think at the heart of making transparency and accountability happen is data about the performance of our public institutions.
Has the 2008 model Nagaraj Bill really led to community participation?
Yes, yeah, the 2005 model Nagaraj Bill. It was announced along with the Jawaharlal Nehru National Urban Renewal Mission. And like most public policy changes, the answer is a bit of both, which is state governments. We do live in a federal system and we live in a cooperative federal system, which is further complicated by the fact that cities are a state subject. And the 74th Constitutional Amendment is somewhat vague about this. And therefore, when the government of India says we want a model Nagaraj bill to be included as a reform, they can't beyond a point impose their will upon state governments. So it's up to state governments to say how much of this are we going to really translate. Yes, there is some amount of leverage that the government of India has because there is some money behind JNURM and that money belongs to the government of India. And that's really the carrot and stick approach that typifies JNURM. So the results of this over the last 5 years since we've had this these reforms in place is that about 12 states have passed the law in some in better or worse form. Not all of them have passed it in a way that would be considered acceptable. And out of these 12 states, I would say about 3 or 4 states have then passed what's called the subordinate legislation, which is notified the rules and actually operationalized it. So we are a long way away from actually seeing the concept of area sabhas and the Nagar Raj bill come alive in the day-to-day experiences that we have as average citizens.
One final question is, Shah Rukh Khan's character in Swadesh really modeled after you?
No, the answer to that is, you know, it's one of those crazy, confusions that came up just around the time when the film was being launched. The director, Ashutosh Goyalkar, was apparently asked, you know, this is a film, it's a fantasy, it's a fictional film, but does it actually happen in real life? And he then alluded to our example of having returned to India and done something and said that this was one example of how these things actually happen. And he like every creative person, has taken inspiration from a variety of sources. But the media being what they are, went to town with that, and then the whole story then mushroomed, I think, beyond the point of realism.
Thank you for joining us at ORF today.
Thank you, and you're doing great work at ORF. Keep up the great work, and I hope that you can make an impact to movement.